Let us prepare for worship through our confession and forgiveness. No, through our Palm Sunday liturgy. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Mercifully assist us, O Lord of our salvation, that we may with joy remember and think about those mighty acts whereby you have given us life everlasting. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" And they said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen. And they were saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." And he answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would shout out." For all, the Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We praise and thank you, O God, for the great acts of love by which you have set us free through your Son. Jesus Christ our Lord, on this day he entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was acclaimed Son of David and King of Kings by those who scattered their garments and branches of palm in his path. We ask that you bless these branches and those who bear them, and grant that we may hail him as our Lord and King, and follow him with perfect confidence. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace, in the name of Christ. the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Sovereign God, you have established your rule in the human heart through the servanthood of Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, keep us in the joyful procession of those who with their tongues confess Jesus as Lord and with their lives praise him as Savior. Amen. May I have the children come up for a children's message? Come on. Bring your palms. Yeah. I know there's a... She was ready to persist, wasn't she? I'll tell you, she's right on. Good morning. You know, what's this? A palm branch, a palm leaf, isn't it? Yeah. You know, when Jesus was coming into Jerusalem and they were all shouting praises, and he said, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. And they were waving these palm branches, you know, as he came by. And they did that because a palm was considered a symbol of victory. There were many festivals in Jesus' day and many festivals that celebrated the victories of God's people. And they would often use these palms as a symbol of that victory. You know where else? These palms were actually engraved in stone on the temple. You had a big temple, it's like a church, you know, in Jerusalem. And on the sides of that temple were engraved these palm branches, again, symbolizing the victory. Now, we symbolize the victory too, don't we, as Christians? But it's not a victory of war. It's a victory of peace with God, because God has forgiven us all our sins and gotten for us a place in heaven too. And peace with one another. One day that'll happen too. But that's a tremendous victory because, you know, war and killing is not right. And one day we'll be free of that. Yeah. And we celebrate that. Yeah. What did they sing? What did they sing when they came in? Blessed be the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Right? Blessed. God's blessings upon the King, and God's blessings from the King too, to us. So that blessing from God is also what we celebrate on Palm Sunday. Yeah, let's do that. We're going to walk around the sanctuary, and Connie, you're gonna. I didn't tell you this, did I? No, that's all right. I love surprises. I want you just to do the chorus. Can you strum the chorus? And we'll sing as.
You want me to play the guitar?
Sure. Oh yes. Unless you want to play the piano.
No. I don't.
Okay. All right. Up. Now we're going to get some exercise. We're going to walk. All right. And can you see that sign back there? That screen? That's where the words will be. Blessed is he who comes in. So as you go that way, you can read them from there. And as you go this way, you can read them from there. Okay? Let Connie sing it through once. Okay? I can do this. I can do it. Blessed Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Wave your branches, people. Come on. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And the bearing of the lean, where we will sing. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. I lost somebody. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Coming of the King. Hosanna, we will sing. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. That's good. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed are you who have come in the name of the Lord. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Oops. Can I have my tablet? It's on this.
Sing and strum the verses, and we will sing just what we did before. Blessed is he who comes.
We hope we match.
And I believe with perfect faith in the coming of Messiah. Even though he tarries, I will wait for him every day. We are not ashamed, we are not afraid. We watch for his returning. Yeshua, our salvation, we proclaim. Yeshua, our Messiah, is the Lamb of God who broke the curse and made a living way. With the trumpet blast, he will come again, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Jerusalem will sing Barak Abba.
Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he. Humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem. And the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read responsively. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord."
Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem.
Jerusalem, built as a city that is bound firmly together. The second reading is found in Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the time of Jesus every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. It was a crisp April day. And the couple was touring Washington, D.C. And they were looking at all the beautiful monuments and the memorials and, you know, the Lincoln Memorial, the Washington Memorial, and some of the war memorials. But for the wife, the one memorial that particularly struck her in her heart was the Vietnam War Memorial. As she rubbed her hands and fingers over the stone, she located a friend of hers who had died in the war. And then she had been given a bracelet by a person who had become a POW in the war and had died in the war too. And she always carried that bracelet with her. So this was a very powerful moment for her. And the stone itself seemed to be speaking to her, as it spoke words of sacrifice and also words of grief, as so many of the soldiers that did come home were not welcomed from that war, which was very unpopular at the time. Speaking stones, huh? That's what Jesus talks about in our gospel lesson for today. The Pharisees had come and said, "Tell your disciples to stop singing. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Don't do that." And Jesus said, "My goodness, if these would be silent, why, the stones would shout it out." Let's see what that might have looked like. How we can experience God's message as shouting stones. Proclaim it to us. Well, first of all, though, why do you think that the Pharisees wanted the disciples to be silent? Huh? Well, there are several possible reasons. One is that anytime somebody talked about a king other than Caesar, the Romans got nervous. And unless it was about Caesar or somebody that Caesar had designated as a king, as they often did in Israel, but other than that, they got nervous and thought that an insurrection might be occurring or about to, so they would clamp down on it, and that's what the Pharisees were afraid of. Yeah. On the other hand, perhaps they were just jealous because they were singing about Jesus, and they were jealous because of the popularity that he had. Yeah. And thirdly, though, there's a third alternative, and that is because the message that Jesus was bringing to them and the message that these people were proclaiming was not the official narrative of the day. Blessed is the King who comes. Blessed is the Son of David, a warrior king. And this is all about peace, isn't it? And humility. Now, why didn't Jesus come in on a great white horse, huh? That would have been appropriate for a king, perhaps. But here he comes in on a donkey, a symbol of humility. And if you look at the passage from Zechariah, the Old Testament passage, it talks about, lo, your king comes to you, triumphant, humble, on a donkey. And what does it say? He brings peace to the nations. Peace. That's not the official narrative. It's war against the Romans. And Jesus wasn't following the narrative. Yeah. We've had experience with that, haven't we, in our society? Huh? The narrative, the Democratic narrative is thus. But the Republican narrative is that. Huh? And the American narrative is, who knows? And where do the facts fit? Do they support the narrative? Have we heard of things like in the media where sometimes we'll omit some of the facts because it doesn't fit the narrative? Yeah. Or we'll change some of the facts to fit the narrative? Huh? Yeah, and Jesus just, again, his words, his message didn't fit the official narrative of the day. Yeah. Well, what narrative do we live by? It's God's narrative, isn't it? A narrative of peace between us and God. There was a fellow by the name of Thomas Cargill. He wrote a commentary in a certain publication, and he talks about this Palm Sunday. And this is what he said. He used an illustration from the Lord of the Rings. In that work, at a certain scene, the fellow, a character by the name of Bilbo. Did anybody read The Lord of the Rings? Yeah. Bilbo, remember him? Yeah. He has pity on another character called Gollum, okay? He spares his life. And another character, Frodo, he tells another character, Gandalf, that he says, I wish he hadn't had pity on Gollum. He said, Gollum deserves the worst. And the fellow says, the pity of Bilbo may rule the fate of many. And the author of this commentary, he says, that's what Christ did on the cross. The mercy of God may rule the fate of many. We don't get what we deserve. We receive pity. We receive mercy. And the idea here is that God doesn't overcome evil with evil. He doesn't overcome evil by trying to destroy evil even. He overcomes it by unraveling it. And that's what Jesus did on the cross. He took evil upon himself and in the process deprived it of its power. He unraveled it. That's God's narrative. And what this passage tells us is that that narrative will not be silenced. It will be spoken out, shouted out by God's stones. That's us, living stones. There was a doctor, Dr. Martha Meyer, who did her work in Yemen. And she was so influential in the area that they killed her. They killed her and two of her co-workers. And her family had a decision to make. Now, were they going to bury her? She was from Alabama. So were they going to bury her back in her home in Alabama, which is what the family wanted? Or were they going to bury her in Yemen, which is what she wanted? Where do you think they ended up burying her? It was in Yemen. And it was her own father who said, yes, we could have her back here and we could visit her here and we won't be able to do that in Yemen. But she said, here, her grave marker would be just another gravestone. There, it is a testimony to her life, to her faith, to the influence she had on those people that she cared for as a doctor and as a Christian. I think that message is going to grow and grow and grow until it covers all of the earth. As it says in our letter to the Philippians, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ, the man of peace, is Lord. It's the message we speak. It's the message we live. Because we are God's shouting stones.
Thank you.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The congregation's response to the words, "Merciful God," is received. Drawn close to the heart of God, we offer these prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. We pray for the church, called to follow Jesus in the way of the cross. Make us unflinching servants of the gospel. Deliver us from hardship as we confront the forces of injustice and practice radical compassion. Merciful God. For those in positions of authority called to lead with integrity and compassion, supply them with courage and vulnerability when challenged with new ideas. Deliver them from fear that limits imagination and impedes justice. Merciful God. For those who suffer, waiting expectantly for mercy and consolation, accompany those who feel abandoned or betrayed. Defend those who are wrongly accused and embrace those who are incarcerated or detained. Merciful God. For Christians around the world preparing this week to journey with Jesus to the cross, reveal to us once again the earth-shaking power of humble service, unmerited forgiveness, and sacrificial love. Lead us all from death to life. Merciful God. We pray for those who are ill, for Marvin Youngmeyer, who will have surgery this week. We pray for success and strong recovery. We pray for Carol Ott, who is back in the hospital's ICU. We pray for recovery of health and power to rest our hopes in you. We pray for Pastor David Carlson, who is in the hospital with pancreatitis. And we pray for others we lift up to you by name. Merciful God, we remember those who have died and who are commended into your hands. We pray for the family and friends of Robert Bishop, who died last Thursday and whose funeral is tomorrow in California. Remember them and us in your kingdom, and prepare a place for each of us with you in paradise. Merciful God, accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of a world in need, for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. We pray. Extravagant God, you have blessed us with the fullness of creation. Now we gather at your feast, where you offer us the food that satisfies. Take and use what we offer here. Come among us and give us the holy, in whose name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy God, creator of all and source of life, At the birth of time, your word brought light into the world. In the fullness of time, you sent your son, Jesus Christ, the word born of Mary. And he is the light that shines in our darkness. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us pray together as our Lord taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." The body of Christ given for you. Amen. The blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Let us pray. Blessed Jesus, in this rich meal of grace, you have fed us with your body and the bread of life. So now send us forth. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.